Vito Genovese loved the old Sicilian ways, even though he himself was from the Italian mainland. He was born November 27, 1897, in Rosolino, Italy, and with his family, he immigrated to New York City in 1913, settling in Manhattan's Little Italy section. He began his criminal career like so many others, stealing merchandise from pushcart vendors and running errands for mobsters. Later, he collected money from people who bet on the numbers. In 1917, during the height of the Mafia Camorra friction in the city, Genovese was arrested for possession of a handgun. He was convicted and sentenced on April 15, 1917 to serve 60 days. During the early 1920s, Genovese started working for Giuseppe Joe the Boss Mazzaria, the boss of one of New York City's powerful mafia factions. Involved in bootlegging and extortion, Genovese's main value to Mazzaria was his propensity for violence. In 1930, Genovese set up to commit his first murder, and the victim would be Gaetano Reyna, a former ally of Mazzaria who had flipped his allegiance to another mafia chief, Salvatore Maranzano. According to reports, Genovese shot Reyna in the back of the head. The Castellamarese War between Mazzaria and Maranzano had been raging since the late 1920s and into 1931. Genovese and Luciano decided to end the feud once and for all by killing Mazzaria. So on April 15, 1931, while Mazzaria was having lunch and playing cards with Luciano, Luciano got up and headed to the restroom. At that point, in rushed Genovese, Bugsy Siegel, and two other gunmen, shooting Mazzaria to death. According to federal informer Joseph Falacci, Genovese may also have been involved in the death of Salvatore Maranzano just a few months later. Numerous reports state that Genovese despised Luciano's friendship with Meyer Lansky, a Jew, and was jealous of his close ties with Frank Costello. According to one writer who is often accused of exaggerating facts, Costello got on Genovese's bad side early on when he gave Vito a nickname, Don Vitone. Originally, Costello meant it as an insult, and he and Luciano had many a laugh at Genovese's expense, according to Martin Ghosh. Supposedly, Genovese didn't like the makeup of the new combination. He believed only Italians should sit on the board of directors. Lansky, a Jew, recommended another Jew to sit on the board, Louis Lepke Buchalter, and Costello recommended a third Jew, Arthur Flegenheimer, also known as Dutch Schultz. At Costello's suggestion, according to Ghosh, Luciano had set up a meeting with the Dutchman at the Claridge Hotel to discuss an affiliation between the two factions, and Genovese exploded. "What the hell is this? What are you trying to do? Load us up with a bunch of Hebes?" Before Benny or Meyer could even open their mouths, Frank Costello almost swung on him, and he said very calmly, "Take it easy, Don Vitone. You're nothing but a f***ing foreigner yourself." From then on, whenever anybody wanted to rub Vito's nose in it, they'd call him Don Vitone to his face or behind his back. And Vito never forgave Frank for reminding him that he wasn't Sicilian and couldn't ever really belong. We will never know if this story is true. Many doubt its authenticity. But one thing is for certain, Genovese was all about power, terror, and murder. A writer for the Mob Museum in Las Vegas, Nevada, hit the nail on its proverbial head when he wrote, "Vito Genovese was ruthless, ambitious, and power-hungry, remembered as much for his heavily feared reputation as for being at least partially responsible for the downfall of organized crime in the United States in the latter half of the 20th century." One report even has Genovese killing the husband of his future wife, Anna, so that he could marry her. And then he supposedly had the hitman killed to silence any possible future revelation of his crime. By 1936, Charlie Luciano was tried and convicted for pandering and prostitution, and Genovese, who served as underboss for the Luciana Borgata, became acting boss. But it also put him on the radar of federal prosecutors. A federal witness told authorities that Genovese had ordered the murder of Ferdinand Baccia. This was news the feds wanted to hear. They issued an arrest warrant for Genovese, but instead of facing the law, he fled for Italy, where he teamed up with Italian dictator Benito Mussolini. At the end of World War II, Genovese was brought back to the United States by federal agents to face trial on his earlier murder charge in the Boccia case. A key witness, however, was poisoned to death in 1945, and Genovese was thus set free. During Genovese's absence, Luciano's friend and ally, Frank Costello, took over as acting boss while Vito was parleying with the fascist dictator. Vito wasn't pleased about Costello's promotion. Slowly, methodically, he began re-establishing his power in the Borgata. According to Joseph Valachi, Genovese wanted to take over the Luciano family and claim the boss of bosses title for himself. But much to his dismay, Luciano was ultimately freed from prison with the understanding he accepts deportation, never to return to the United States, not even the Western Hemisphere. But in 1946, Luciano was able to secure a passport and, with the help of Lansky and Costello, traveled to Cuba, where he called a meeting of the combination bosses. Lucky liked Cuba. If he couldn't return to the United States, he would just stay on the tropical island and run his operations from there. But someone tipped off the U.S. State Department to Luciano's presence. Specifically, they informed Harry J. Anslinger, director of the Federal Bureau of Narcotics. Some reports state that Genovese may have been the one who ratted on Luciano. As a result, Charlie Lucky was eventually forced to leave Cuba and return to his exile in Italy. Then Genovese began to systematically remove all obstacles in his way as he ascended to the top of the Luciano family. He arranged for the murder of Luciano ally Willie Moretti in 1951. Then, as luck would have it, Joey Adonis was deported back to Italy. Again, some believe Genovese may have had a hand in the ousting of Adonis. He then turned his attention to Frank Costello. In May 1957, on Genovese's orders, hitman Vincent the Chin Gigante shot Costello in the head. Luckily for Costello, the wound was superficial. It was close enough, though, for Costello, who retired from the top spot and surrendered control of the Luciano family to Genovese. There was just one more person to take care of, and that was the Mad Hatter himself, Albert Anastasia, another Luciano ally. Genovese feared the Lord High Executioner of Murder Incorporated, afraid he would go on a tirade seeking to avenge his friends Costello and Luciano. Law enforcement was never sure, but Genovese, many believe, caught up with Anastasia on October 25, 1957. With the deck cleared, Genovese called a conference of the commission to discuss his actions as well as to discuss mob business in New York. He explained that he was now in charge of what would be called the Genovese family. Exiled in Italy, Luciano was powerless to stop him. But the now infamous 1957 conclave known as the Appalachian Meeting was a bust. Though stories vary as to how the mobsters were caught in the dragnet, the most often repeated account goes something like this. A local sheriff's deputy on routine patrol spotted numerous large cars in the small town going to the home of Joseph Barbara. He called it in, and then all hell broke loose. But was this just a chance sighting by a low-paid civil servant? Some believe that this was revenge, meant to embarrass the self-proclaimed boss of bosses, and that the police were tipped off days before the meeting by the machinations of Luciano, Costello, and Meyer Lansky. 6 months later, the feds finally caught up to Genovese. Again, insiders report that an anonymous source informed the feds to Vito's racket. Many now believe the testimony against him was fabricated. The government's star witness was Nelson Cantalops, a Puerto Rican drug dealer who claimed Genovese met with him. In 1959, Genovese was convicted of selling a large quantity of heroin. On April 17, 1959, Genovese was sentenced to 15 years in the Atlanta Federal Penitentiary. Several court observers, as well as law enforcement sources, suspected that Cantalops was lying, pointing out that it would be significantly out of character for a major crime boss to involve himself directly in any criminal operation, let alone a drug deal. Genovese continued as boss over his empire from behind bars. And his rivals, especially those he thought were responsible for his 15-year sentence, continued to be executed. But Genovese's recklessness and paranoia led him to suspect Joseph Valachi had become an informer. Valachi was a soldier in his own family. In true mafia fashion, he gave Valachi the kiss of death. Terrified, Valachi murdered a fellow inmate he thought was gunning for him, and when interrogated, spilled the beans on the workings of the American mafia. Genovese, the man who wanted to be the boss of bosses, lived the next 10 years in a small cell in federal prison, never able to enjoy the success of ascending to the top. He died of a heart attack on February 14, 1969, at the U.S. Medical Center for Federal Prisoners at Springfield, Missouri. He was 71 years old. His remains are buried in St. John's Cemetery in Queens. Many believe Luciano, Lansky, and Costello, as payback, may have been the ones who worked out a deal with Nelson Cantaloupes to falsify testimony against Genovese.